First on BBC Two, Beetlemania, and we're not talking music. This time, it's the car that's a star.
Behold the hunk of junk that just won't quit. A car that by rights should have bitten the dust a long, long time ago. A car that has instead stubbornly refused to die, outliving the critics who repeatedly wrote it off.
This used to be an example of the world's most significant and influential car. Since 1938, over 21 million Beetles have been sold all around the globe. They're still being made, still being sold, and we're still counting. This is the world's most popular car by a county mile, and it's one that very nearly didn't happen.
Austrian-born engineer Ferdinand Porsche had a vision of a true people's car. Porsche started his own design bureau in 31 and laid out the plans for his Volkswagen, or people's car. And his dream of an affordable, practical car for the masses was shared by another high-profile Austrian. When the Brühl-creamed madman became German Chancellor in 33, he ordered Germany's motor industry to help Porsche in his aim to mobilise the masses. Domestic manufacturers scoffed. The head of BMW thought the working classes should walk or get the bus. But Porsche persevered with his cunning design. His car for the people had its engine at the back to give greater traction, and the motor was air-cooled for simplicity and reliability. It rode on cleverly compact torsion bar suspension, which, for the standards of the day, gave both a decent ride and more space in the cabin. Hitler was delighted. The final design was given a catchy Nazi name, the Strength Through Joy Car, or KVF Wagen, and a brand new factory built on land around Castle Wolfsburg, which was imaginatively renamed Strength Through Joy Town. The early advertising emphasised the car's roundy-round lines, and over 300,000 unlucky punters signed up for the KDF Wagen savings scheme. Unlucky because thanks to Adolf's hobby of waging global war, they never got to see their cars. The money was found intact after the war, though it wasn't until 61 that VW paid it back. Most wartime production was devoted to the Kubelwagen, a severe-looking staff car using KDF mechanicals. When the shooting stopped, things looked bleak in Strength Through Joytown. The VW works had already been hammered by Allied bombers, and an order was given for it to be destroyed. Then came a reprieve, thanks to British Army officer Major Ivan Hurst. The Allies desperately needed transport for post-war reconstruction, and Hurst cranked the ravaged line back into life. Big League car makers visited the renamed Wolfsburg factory to assess this spoil of war and weren't impressed. Ford backed off when they realised exactly how close it was to the Soviet zone, while British motor magnate William Rootes thought the Beetle would only be saleable for 2 or 3 years at best. Drive one 50 years later and you wonder why they ever sold at all, because this was austerity with a capital A. It had a crash gearbox, cable-operated brakes, a miserable 25 bhp, which meant it had all the get-up-and-go of the Reichstag. Plus, because this was post-war, shortage of resources, the only glue they could get was made out of fish. So those early cars
smelt like Grimsby in the rain. But as they gradually ironed out the problems, the legend of this weird little German car started to spread.
We found a wonderful bargain, a little Beetle Volkswagen. He came all the way from Germany to settle here in this country. He said, yeah, 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 and he laughed. He said, this is the place for me.
My father founded Colborne Garages in 1939, mainly as a general repair business, selling used cars. And in 1947, a gentleman returning from the control commission in Germany came in with a car called a Volkswagen, wanted to part exchange it for an estate car that we had on the forecourt. And we didn't know what a Volkswagen was. No one knew what a Volkswagen was. But after obviously a little bit of investigation and debate, we bought it. And father drove JLT, as it happened, for 10 days and announced to his staff that he was going to specialise in it. He reckoned that it was really something unique. He compared it to a vintage Bentley in those days because the low revving engine and the gear ratios were probably its secret to its reliability and the fact that you could get into the car, drive it to Scotland, and you wouldn't bat an eyelid at doing so. It was reliable. You couldn't do that in a Morris 8 or all the other cars that were available in those days. It was a remarkable car. So specialising them we did, and we've been doing so ever since.
But it was across the Atlantic where the Beetle really earned its spurs. The affluent society took VW to new and dizzy heights. The US in the 50s and 60s was an age of conspicuous consumption, but not everyone was buying into the dream. Owning one of those funny little German imports became the perfect anti-capitalist, anti-conformist statement.
Volkswagen owners, the New York Times had an article and they called them contrarians. So you're a little bit different than other people.
It was a very different car. It represented an honest car, no chrome, no tail fins, no massive V8 engine. It was just a totally different car than we Americans were used to.
The most impressive thing about a Volkswagen dealer in those days was the requirements set up by the factory. The factory required the dealer to carry enough parts to actually build a whole vehicle, and this was totally unheard of.
They were virtually indestructible, they had great gas mileage, and you could live in them if you had to, and just a lot different than the American cars. It was something different.
There was a great need for a utilitarian small automobile. Inexpensive to run and get you where you wanted to. Low cost, maintenance was minimal, and they weren't ready for it.
The Pontiac Star Chief Custom Catalina.
Nor were the big American manufacturers ready for the way VW marketed their cars. Stateside car makers liked to promote their fantastically over-the-top metal with equally over-the-top ads. But VW had hired a little-known ad agency, Doyle Dane Birnbach, who tried something US TV viewers had never been exposed to before. Ironic understatement.
Have you ever wondered how the man who drives a snowplow drives to the snowplow? This one drives a Volkswagen. So you can stop wondering.
And a long-running series of print ads continued the theme, daring to poke fun at the car they were trying to sell. The Beetle was ugly. The Beetle was laughable. The Beetle was a lack of status symbol. And another thing, the 60s were a time of change. Neil Armstrong walked on the moon. The war in Vietnam got totally out of control. And then there was John, Paul, George and Ringo, the Beatles plural. But the Beetle hardly changed at all, something that didn't escape the ad men. And as the 60s exploded into a frenzy of anti-capitalist free love, the Beetle became the perfect hippie motor, whether in its unadulterated state or customised beyond recognition. The irony of the love bug's origins didn't seem to matter at all. The verdict was in. The people loved the people's car.
You only have to look at the curved shape of the Beetle to see that it borrows a lot from nature. Now, this is an unusual in car design. We have cars like the Jaguar, the Panther, and the Viper, but these animals are about speed and power. Beetles in nature are fairly ordinary lumbering animals, but as most natural historians will agree, they're perhaps the most successful creatures ever to have roamed the earth. There are certain forms in nature that provoke specific responses in the human brain. For example, a newborn baby has abnormally large eyes for the size of its head, has fat pudgy arms which make it seem vulnerable and appealing. Now the Beetle mimics this to some degree. It has this nice smiley face on the bonnet. It has these large headlamps, rather like eyes, which together with an ungainly shape give it the essence of its appeal. It's from the back that it looks most like a Beetle. And after all, it's a car with an engine in the boot. It's the car that dares to be different, and perhaps why, for so many people, it's far more than a machine.
He's right. It had become a personality that triggered warm and fuzzy feelings. And as the love bug contagion spread, owners would salute each other with an affectionate wave as if greeting a member of a mythical family. Things had got completely out of hand.
I'll never forget the moment we kissed the night of the hayride.
Soon people started to give their Beetles names because they felt they had personality, soul, a little heart you could hear beating at the back. Disney didn't choose our friend here by accident. They knew that it was a car that could make normal, right-thinking, level-headed people go completely misty-eyed. And as affection for the car grew, so did a rather impossible set of urban myths. Heel boy!
You must be joking. Well, my VW is a complete rust bucket. I bought it about 3 years ago when my student loan came in. Paid £950 for it, and it was great. I loved it. It was, looked pristine. It was fabulous. But when the MOT started to run out, the horrible truth began to emerge. There were holes just about everywhere, in the floor pan, where the spare wheel was, just about everywhere. But then again, after 27 years, what do you expect?
We decided to try and cross the Irish Sea in a Volkswagen. I borrowed my mate's mum's Volkswagen, and we tested out the lake first of all. We drove it down the slope into the lake, and of course it filled up with water and sank pretty quickly. So then we welded up the doors, so we had to go into the sunroof, and then we filled in all the holes on the bottom, because there are holes on the bottom. We set across the Irish Sea. And we got about, I think we were going for about 8 hours, about 15 miles. But it still eventually filled up, and it sank, and that was it, really.
No, this is a Volkswagen. They were never badged as Beetles. The name's just a nickname, and only later on in its life did the company ever use the word. Indeed, it's the only car I can think of where the company took the name of the car rather than a manufacturer picking a name for a car. This was the people's car. The company was established to build the people's car, so this is the Volkswagen.
By the late 60s, the people's car was being assembled in three plants in Germany, plus another 15 countries across the globe. But even at the height of its powers, VW knew they couldn't rely on the bug forever. The Type 3 of 1961 had been a valiant attempt to enlarge the Beetle family. But the 1968 Type 4 was far too heavy, too slow, and too expensive to succeed. Worse was yet to come in 71 when VW abandoned the rear-engine layout that had served the Beetles so well in favour of a front-engine, water-cooled design, the calamitous K70. Badly designed and expensive to make, the K70 was a big metal turkey. In the early 70s, they tried to update the car with fancy new McPherson strut suspension and a wraparound screen, but it was too late. The so-called Super Beetle lasted 4 unsuccessful years. The car that refused to die was slowly killing the company that made it. Not a moment too soon, in 74, Volkswagen unveiled the Golf. A bundle of chunky fun that saved its bacon. Water-cooled, front-engined, and an absolute pleasure to drive, VW proved that they weren't a one-car wonder after all, and the Beetles' days looked numbered. In January 78, the last German-made Beetle chuffed off the production line. With the end of mainstream production, it was left to a hardy band of enthusiasts with Dewey eyes and MIG welders to keep the legend alive.
There are hundreds of reasons why the Beetle isn't a good car. You sit there with your nose against the windscreen, the heater doesn't work, they're noisy, there's no room for luggage, there's only two doors. But they're an endearing car. When you drive a Beetle down the road, it takes you over. It's a way of life. It's just a superb car to drive. It's just a car that defies all logic. But they've made millions of them. And the car is still as popular as ever. It's a car that you can't really improve now. There have been hundreds and hundreds of modifications to the Beetle, but by now the car is just about perfect. Over the last 35 years, I've owned hundreds of Beetles, and I hate to think how much I've spent. It probably cost me my marriage. She said to me, it's me or the cars, and I chose the cars.
Strange but true, in Germany, demand went up after production finished, forcing VW to import cars from Mexico. And dwindling demand in Brazil saw the local factory close in 86, only to reopen 7 years later when the government demanded, guess what? A car for the people.
No such luck in America, though, where new clean air legislation meant that the executioner's axe had to fall. A cute fuel injection version of the cabriolet soldiered on for a couple more years, but eventually Volkswagen said, that's it. Sentimentality aside, enough is enough.
But actually, it wasn't, because now we have a brand new Beetle. In 1994, Volkswagen reinvented its past in the form of a motor show concept car and found themselves deafened by demands from all over the world to make it. So make it they did. And now that fluffy nostalgia is available in your local showroom, are we falling in love all over again? Sure, it's undeniably cute and curvy in a 21st century kind of way.
But ironically, this is the complete antithesis of a people's car. It's refined, it's comfortable, it's expensive, and the engine is in the front, not the back. And there's another irony. This is based on the Golf, the car that saved Volkswagen from bankruptcy. But it's not a proper Beetle, not in the accepted sense. It's a bit of corporate heritage management to make people feel warm about the brand. It may be a hot seller, but one thing's for sure, it'll never, ever come close to eclipsing the success of the most popular car in the world.
The newspapers shout, a new style is growing, but it don't know if it's coming or going. Some is good, some is bad, and the joke is right.